And so what is it that's underneath the language? What is it that's behind our understanding of who they are? What would Jesus do if he walked into Galiwinku today, if he walked into Milingimbi, Gangan, and sat with the people? What would he be talking about? How would he understand their relationship with each other, their relationship with the land, their relationship with authority? How they celebrate, how they really celebrate? And how would he come into the center of that and transform it from the inside out? Just like he wants to do with me. He doesn't want me to stop speaking Spanish or loving fish tanks or doing gardening. He just enhances that as he's in the center of my life. So with a culture, when Jesus comes into a culture, he transforms it from the inside out. And unfortunately, we're multiplying what we grew up with in Sunday school. We're multiplying what we knew, what connected us with God, rather than creating a space and opening a space where, in this case, the Yolngu nation, or when I'm in Noongar country, the Noongar nation, how they connect with God, how they would do Sunday school, how they would do a church service. And so what we're beginning to explore with some of the senior Christian leaders, some of the senior tribal leaders who actually have the responsibility already, and they have the authority already to disciple their nation. They don't need to be given that authority by anybody. It's innately God-given there. And so I'm walking alongside traditional Christian leaders to explore with them the concept of what it means to be 100% Yolngu and 100% Christian. There's a bit of a wave coming again, it comes every 20 or 30 years, where we condemn culture as pagan. We condemn anything secret as pagan. We condemn anything we don't understand as pagan. And therefore, we bring in the Jesus that we grew up with, the Jesus that was meaningful to us. My Jesus spoke English. My Jesus did little Bible study books. That's how I became a believer in Central America when I was growing up. It was very real for me. But it doesn't necessarily work in Yolngu, in Elcho Island, in Milingimbi, in Gangan. And so what we're doing together with senior Christian leaders is exploring what's below the tip of the iceberg. What is it that we as Christians don't even see in your culture, don't even understand is going on when you sit differently in the dark? And I keep wanting to say, come into the light, come closer, come and have a look at what's going on. But there's a very significant reason why people are sitting in the darkness in their clan groups. I don't have the answers. And that's partly why I'm useful. I don't think I have the answers. I know I don't. But I've traveled across enough cultures to know that Jesus is experienced differently in Spanish Central America than he is in indigenous villages in the Solomon Islands. And so my job is merely to support the Christian leaders and say, yes, you have the authority. Yes, you have the responsibility. What can I do to help facilitate the discussion? Part of my gifting, part of my calling is to set people to move, to dance. And so the example I'm going to use now is a dance example. The other thing is I'm a gardener. I have a garden back home in Toowoomba that's entered in a big competition that's judged in a couple of weeks, and I'll have 4,000 people through my garden. I'm a gardener. So when I'm in community, what do I connect with? I connect with the gardeners. I do work with the people who are trying to establish fruit and veggies in their back garden. I work with the Shire Council to look at how can we reinvigorate this farm area. You see, it's just me being me, bringing Jesus with me into every area that I can. So it's not always tidy. It's not always predictable. Things change every time I come to Arnhem Land with what opens up. But my heart is to say, how can I support the traditional leaders who know Jesus so that they can step into their place of authority and be recognized and have the courage to actually begin to say, that's my muck, that's Yakamai muck. That's good, that's acceptable to God. This we need to step away with. Just as in my culture, I've had to step away from things. I'm going to put the video in a moment. It's 8 minutes, and it's it happened just south of here at Riala, where we brought ladies from four different communities. And when you hear the lady speaking at the end, I want you to hear that I didn't teach anything. All I did was create a space where the tradition elders, so those of you here before Guta came in, she's just in between two really important appointments about getting a kidney transplant today. So she was going to speak, but she isn't able to be here. But she came and she spoke. The elders with authority and responsibility came and spoke about what was okay with dancing, what did we need to be careful of, who are the dance leaders who you have to get permission of before you use that particular movement. They have all of the knowledge. I didn't have the knowledge. I just said, hey, let's get together, let's get some good food, let's get the key people who are moving in the Christian community, and let's spend some time sharing together. So when you see this, and I was stunned by her comment at the end, it's the Lord releasing something in them. And this is just about dance. It's not about the celebration, it's not about honoring, it's not about relationship, it's not about authority, it's not about how we learn. It's just about dance. But it was incredibly powerful and a beautiful, wonderful time that we had.
Ah. Culturally back at Wangang, it's a difficult and challenging, but this workshop has helped me and put me into another level. I personally see myself being into that level, and now I feel confidence that I can do whatever back at Kaliwinko through culturally dancing a movement that pleases God alone. God has also helped Marang, that gave me the meaning, the clear picture, even the names of the specific patterns, the style, the movement that I dance. Now I finally have the meaning, the pattern, the movement with my body, the hands that I do. Now that it has the story, that in my mind I can walk with that story with the Lord, with my Lord. So this workshop, I've seen myself. It has did a shift on me. And I praise Lord. And I praise, I even thank those people that have run and given us this opportunity to be part of this and taken us and given us the clear teaching that we wanted to hear and capture and take back with us. Thank you.
Fabulous. And again, I want to stress that it was the Holy Spirit teaching, because there was no theory. There was just an open space for senior Christians to sit together and to discuss together in a safe way. And in a moment, I'm going to invite Maracha and Marpalwe to come up and to join me and to share a little bit from their heart. But I do, just before, I want to say this can be quite an intimidating space to talk, because for so long, so many people have said that our stuff is wrong. So I'm going to ask you to be gentle and to listen with your heart as they take some public tentative steps of stuff that we've been discussing right across the country, right across the nation of young people. I had a conversation with Yina where she said, sometimes I feel ashamed when I'm dancing at funerals. And I said, Yina, is it because Jesus has left the funeral? Is it because his presence has gone? Or is it because of the people who are watching and their judgment? And she said, Jesus never left. God is doing something new in Arnhem Land. And I'm excited. It's awkward, it's messy, it's difficult, it's challenging. But it's fabulously deep and powerful. As we can give permission for the young Christian leaders to unpack the God-given truth that's buried deep in their culture, that was here before we came, and that Australia actually is waiting to hear. The God truths that are in Yolngu culture will transform the politics of this nation, it will transform the economy of this nation, it will transform the way we see the Lord Jesus, and revival will come. And I believe that the Yolngu are just one of the nations that have authority to begin that ball rolling, so that we can learn what God put into this land that we haven't seen yet, that we've missed in our busyness. So, Marcha, would you like to come up and share a little bit? And Marpalwe, do you want to come up? You want to come? Don't be scared. They're friendly people. So this is Marpalwe. I met her in Yirkala, and she's done some stuff with whaling women and has particular responsibility for the homelands and going out and bringing Jesus to the homelands through the Uniting Church. There's some lovely stuff going on. Do you want to share from your heart?
Thank you, David, for giving this opportunity. My name is Marpalawi Marika. I'm the pastor of Gangan Homeland Church. Gangan is 1 hour by plane and about 3 hours drive from Yirkala. What is in my culture? I'll first of all speak in my language, to those that know my language. Gangan yangono ngara ngayangono. Gangan yangono witch. Witch ngayangono ngayangono ulangorongono nyolongo lurkon or marchin. Marchin urongono ngayambal payrun. Kangayaga parama ninan ngunale. Parama ninan ngay madalanchon ka karpulumon madamarchin. Marchin na mada wikang al marchi orang unan ringga ya lor kunto ringgit malang rom malang rom malang dolan malang. What I said about Gangan, it is the spiritual being, a place of the beginning of the culture. The man that lived there was called Brahma. He had to send two of the men towards east and the other one man called Galpurumon towards one to east and one to south. These three men, this is not a sacred story, this is a story that I've been passed on from generation to generation, and my father and my grandfather. It is in Gangan, that is the place where it actually happened, and that's why the travel was made. What is there in my culture that I need to be strong? What is there, my identity as being a Yolngu Christian? What is there in my culture, in my song line, in my dance, that I could be able to be glorifying Garay? I believe it is in our culture that is embedded. It is in our song line, it is in our stories. There are many, many people that have kept it, but I believe this is the time that our song line and our dances need to be redeemed. There are songs that are in our song line that can actually bring glory to God. Ngringa ekara yo manika yo ngalmorongal kapungul yo ngalmor deangala ergo woktun bonan ekara yo ya. Ngringa yungunan ngay namala yungunan ngay ukur deangala ngay ukur nin ngay ukur dandi. Tenggalair kongal mo warang kumandongunan. Ngringan do na kun bungul yo ka manika yo ngal mo ngal natri rongunan dani on nganya kat na papen. What I just said, with our song lines and with our dance, we can touch the heart of God, because God knows our language. God knows my Te'i language, God knows the Tuala language, God knows the Jamatwengo language, God knows every languages that I won't mention is right across Arnhem land, even the central as well. What is there that I can be able to express myself in the song lines and in the dances that can touch the heart of God? And I know it's very hard, but in every culture, in every, whether it's Tuwa and Yiricha, there are songs. And our men and our women and our children can learn. We can learn and we can teach. Thank you.
Perfect love casts out fear. The Lord did not give us a spirit of fear, but of love, of power, and a sound mind. And for those of us who have not grown up in your culture, fear is an immediate trigger when people start using keywords that we've been taught as Australians are pagan or are wrong. But as we become fearless, we are able to engage with people who know the Spirit of God, who hear the Spirit very clearly, and they're able to instruct us in how to get rid of our fear and to begin to engage in a godly, loving way with a gift of God in this nation. Maracha.
Well, good afternoon, Bookman. This theme of this conference about the gathering of all the nations under Jesus at that time, coming together and be giving thanks to God for what He's given us. There were people from every tribe and language singing songs in their home, songs in native tongue. And that gives me sort of something that we all look forward to. You know, I went to Papua New Guinea, did my training for the translation workshop in Okoronpa, and listening to stories like reading stories about, Don Richardson, and stories about how God was working with all the people groups, that God was revealing Himself. And that this gives a challenge to pursue that direction. God is amazing. He's even working in this translation work, helping me to understand the essence, what it means to be like living like a Yolngu person, not just somebody else, because God wants us to be real, not just like a banda, but Yolngu people. And there's a direction for many of us, the challenges for many of the leaders, because I think it's now the time to, look through to all that what God is asking for us. Give us the Spirit. Kalungu community, 1979, the early revival. But that place was touched by the Holy Spirit, and the people just knew about God straight away. They do songs and dances. If God can do it, He can do it even now. Amen. Sometimes there were, this mental thing gets in and in the way, and we have to, think about God, that He's he cares for all of us. He's got a plan and a purpose for all of us. I just would like to, I'm praying that God will God's going to do that work even for our many people right across Kalungu, not just Elcho Island, but indigenous people. It's God's plan, even the language and the a cultural expression of worship is to be somewhat place where we can really understand and get to the place where God can talk to us and give us direction, you know. We all know that this is good and bad in every culture, but God gives us the tools. He's given us spirit, his word, to get us on track. And that's very amazing for many of our Yolngu people, Aboriginal people right across the board. That's the thing that I would like to express to you guys today. I thank you for David inviting me to speak, giving me the opportunity to share this message to you guys. Thank you.
So as we wrap up, there are stories already that I have heard within your history and song lines that have ignited my faith and have excited me, but it's not mine to share. But the day will come when we give them permission to be 100% Yolngu whilst being 100% Christian, and to resist the wave that says you need to let go of who you are, you need to let go of your identity, you need to let go of your culture in order to come into a relationship with Jesus. For those of you who'd like to connect and talk some more about that, this is a really big topic, a big conversation, and there's lots of things that trigger in us. I have some cards here. Because I am convinced that free people, free people. And as we can set free people to be fully Yolngu, particularly leaders, because they have the responsibility and the authority to disciple their nations already, their clans, their tribes. But as we can support them to be free of fear, to be free of control, to be free of what ifs if we step in and even make mistakes, then I believe that we will see hundreds and thousands of Aboriginal people set free across our nation, and then our nation will receive the blessing that God has destined for it. Thank you very much.